So good evening. I think most of you know that I'm Sister Kathy Duffy, and I'm the director of the Institute for Religion and Science here at Chestnut Hill College, a regional center exploring science and spirituality. And I would like to welcome you very warmly to our Sugarloaf campus and to this evening's lecture. As many of you know, the Institute aims to promote the constructive engagement of religion and spirituality with science and technology, to encourage dialogues in these areas that is interfaith, multi-science, and civil. We sponsor lectures, reading circle, and a variety of other events. Do check our website for a growing number of videos. I think that this is one of our best treasures. These speakers we've had, I think, over 30 speakers, and they're almost that many videos. We lost a few in the beginning, but Andrew, who is back there videotaping, he's been taking care of them the last year, and we've gotten a lot of them up on, and they're very good. I even used one in a conference I was giving, and I found it very helpful. We also have a list of relevant books, science and religion books, that are housed in our library. We got a donation of 200 books. And, the list is there. And if there's anything that you're interested in, you can always borrow it from our library. We have a blog that we write to about once every 3 months. Maybe one of these days we'll get good at that. And then to be sure to sign up on the mailing list if you haven't received the mailing, the last mailing, because we'll be glad to put you on the list, and then at least you'll know when our events are and you can come to those. So our next lecture is scheduled for Monday, I think it's October 24th at 7 o'clock. It's going to be Dr. Noreen Hertzfeld. She's a computer scientist with a theology background, and she will engage questions such as, can we really outsource our minds to the computers? People are talking about uploading their minds, and we can certainly put some of our mind there, but not, anyway, she has some interesting perspectives on that. And we're also presently in the midst of planning some events for next semester, so stay tuned. And do join us when you can. So it's a pleasure for me to introduce to you this evening's lecturer, Dr. Nancey Murphy. Dr. Murphy is Senior Professor of Christian Philosophy at Fuller Theological Seminary in Pasadena, California. She has degrees from Creighton University, the University of California, Berkeley, and Graduate Theological Union. And in fields such as philosophy, psychology, philosophy of science, and theology. So my goodness, very broad understanding of the topic that we're talking about tonight. Her first book won the American Academy of Religion Award for Excellence. She's an author of 10 books, including Theology in the Age of Scientific Reasoning, Bodies and Souls, or Spirited Bodies, and Did My Neurons Make Me Do It? Philosophical and Neurobiological Perspectives on Moral Responsibility and Free Will. And she's co-editor of 13 more books. So, a wonderful array of scholarship. Her research interests focus on the role of modern and postmodern philosophy in shaping Christian theology, on relations between theology and science, and relations among neuroscience, philosophy of mind, and Christian anthropology. So we're trying this semester to look at neuroscience, things about the brain, science and religion about the brain. So this is a perfect lecture for that. Now, I would love to share more details about Nancy, but if I do, then she doesn't get a chance to talk. So I'll stop here and say that we really are fortunate to be able to spend the next hour and a half or so, with a scholar who has devoted her life to researching some of the most difficult questions involving the intersection between science and theology, and especially of the brain. We're truly blessed to share in the fruit of Nancy's years of reflection. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Nancey Murphy.
Well, thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you even more so for the invitation to be here. I've really appreciated the hospitality of your college during the time I've been here. The title of my talk tonight is, Do Humans Have Minds? Neuroscientific and Biblical Issues. I'm quite delighted to be here, as I've just said. There's a handful of denominations that I always prefer when I get speaking invitations, and Catholic institutions are on that short list. It's convenient that the topic this year is theology and neuroscience, since that's been a central interest of mine for a number of years. So I'll be speaking largely about the effects of neuroscience on theological views of humans. There are a surprising number of views of human nature in our culture, and largely these differences go unnoticed, but they underlie a lot of issues that do get discussed. For example, when Dolly the sheep was cloned, someone from the media called me to get a Christian's perspective and seemed surprised and even disappointed that I wasn't adamantly opposed to the idea of human cloning. I asked him if he thought a cloned human would be something like the zombies of science fiction, bodies without minds or souls. He said yes, and I told him not to worry, none of us has a soul. Let me insert a note on terminology here. Mind and soul can be used interchangeably in some eras of philosophy. For example, Descartes in the 16th century used the Latin anima or the French l'âme, and these can be translated either as soul or as mind. In early English translations, the terms were generally translated as soul, but in later philosophers, detecting more recent associations of soul with religion, now translate Descartes' terms as mind. In very general terms, there are three current positions on human nature. The one that I support is usually called physicalism in philosophy. And this means that we are made of only one kind of stuff, a physical body. Typical Christians are divided between body-soul dualism and a tripart account of body, soul, and spirit. However, liberal theologians are non-dualists, even though they don't usually use the term physicalism. And there's a lively debate amongst conservative theologians between dualism and physicalism. From what I've read, it seems that biblical... let me back up a second. Catholics, I think, are one of the most interesting groups here. From what I've read, it seems that biblical scholars are more likely to be physicalists, while theologians, especially those with conservative leanings, are more likely to be dualists. Might be an issue of how close or far you are from the Vatican. Yeah. So my plan for this lecture is to go quickly over the changes in Christian theories of human nature brought about by science, but focus on the current effects of neuroscience. It's important to keep in mind as I go through this material that there were no sharp distinctions among religion, science, and philosophy until late in the modern era. So I may appear to be confusing philosophy and science in this account. I claim that there are five major points in Western history where science or philosophy has called for a reappraisal of theories of human nature. I'll begin with what I take to be the biblical view. The first post-biblical change was the gradual Platonizing of Christian theology. Second was the adaptation of the theological tradition to ancient Aristotelian philosophy in the Middle Ages, best represented in the work of Thomas Aquinas. The third was the replacement of this Aristotelian Thomistic synthesis, beginning with physics, in the 17th century. The fourth was the Darwinian Revolution in biology. The fifth major scientific impact is taking place right now due to the influences of contemporary neuroscience. It's becoming increasingly obvious to many that the functions once attributed to the soul or mind are better understood as functions of the brain. I'll describe earlier changes as briefly as I can, but then devote most of my time to neuroscience. I end with an important caveat regarding physicalism. There are two versions, reductive and non-reductive. Christians need to work out a convincing account of why our higher human capacities, such as morality and spirituality, cannot simply be reduced to brain events. So, section one, does the Bible teach dualism? When we read the Bible, we find the words soul and spirit. Many readers take this to mean that the Bible teaches dualism or tripartism. But I and many biblical scholars believe that these words were not used by the biblical authors to refer to constituent parts of humans, but were rather used to emphasize different aspects or functions or characteristics of humans who were basically composed of matter, the dust of the ground as in Genesis. I noted above that few theologians use the term physicalism. When I taught a seminar on human nature with my theology colleague, Veli Matti Karkkinen, he noted that another term sometimes used for a holistic view is dual aspect monism. He suggested that a better term for theologians would be multi-aspect monism. That is, we are unified beings, but as Paul recognized, we have multiple dimensions: our embodiment, our fleshness, which attests to our frailty and weakness, our dependence on the satisfaction of appetites and desires, and especially the inescapability of death. But there is also our essential sociality, our relationality, deep and sustained motivations, and especially the capacity to be touched by God. This is not to say that body-soul dualism was not an option in the New Testament era. This was because Greek philosophical influences had been present among the Hebrews for at least 200 years before Jesus' day. But if I and so many other scholars are correct to believe that the biblical authors rejected dualism, we need an explanation for why so many people today see dualism in the Bible. A major factor was the adaptation of Christian theology to the philosophical world of the Mediterranean era during the first centuries of the church. This brings me to the topic of my next section, the gradual adoption of a Platonic theory of human nature, or perhaps I should say Platonistic, because it's not exactly Plato's own. So Plato. It's been difficult to find an account specifically of the development of doctrines regarding human nature throughout Christian history. But here is one that I, only an amateur historian, have put together, and it gives me a bit of pause knowing that there are some real historians of theology here. Early Christian teaching on the afterlife, such as that of Clement of Rome, writing around the year 95, focused on immortality as a gift from God and as a consequence of resurrection of the body. with no mention of a soul. The fate of those who were not saved was simply death. His contemporary, Ignatius of Antioch, though, spoke of the everlasting fire as described in Matthew 25:41, but this was an everlasting means of quick extermination of those who were lost. The first mention in Christian teaching of an immortal soul was in the Epistle to Diognetus, written around 130. Athenagoras was the first to link Plato's philosophical conviction of the natural immortality of the soul with the Christian doctrine of the punishment of the wicked, and to conclude that the damned would suffer eternally. Tertullian, living from 160 to 240, is most responsible for crafting Latin theology's doctrine of hell. He accepted Plato's arguments for the immortality of the soul, but rejected the soul's preexistence. Augustine, as the greatest ancient synthesizer of theology, could be said to have cemented the concepts of body-soul dualism and afterlife as the soul's immortality into Christian teaching. However, he maintained the biblical expectation of resurrection of the body. But this was to be a reclothing of a naked soul with a glorified body. Section 3, the Aristotelian Revolution. Aristotle was Plato's student, but his writings did not play much of a role in Christian theology until the late Middle Ages. Aristotle's philosophy involved a metaphysical theory, that is, a theory about the stuff that makes up the world, called hylomorphism, meaning that all physical things are composed of what he called prime matter, but they are given their specific characteristics and powers by a version of Plato's ideas or forms. For Plato, these are something like blueprints existing in a transcendental realm. For Aristotle, the form is inherent in the object, and among living things, the form can also be called the soul. Thus, plants, animals, and humans all have souls of increasingly complex sorts. In the later Middle Ages, European scholars acquired a large body of Aristotle's writings, and theologians struggled to come to terms with them. Thus, Catholic teaching began to describe the human soul as the form of the body. I'll describe Thomas's adaptation of Aristotle's concept of the soul in much greater detail when I come to the neuroscience section of this lecture. It's widely believed that science and Christianity are at war. However, this perception was largely due to the fact that Christianity had been so neatly woven into a worldview influenced by Aristotle's philosophy. When modern astronomy and cosmology, Copernicus and Galileo, proposed a new model of the heavens, this had repercussions throughout the medieval worldview, including a radical revolution in physics. This involved the replacement of Aristotelian Thomist hylomorphism with an entirely new theory of matter, atomism. Atomism was an equally ancient theory based on the assumption that matter is not infinitely divisible. At some point, one comes to particles that are uncuttable. In fact, atom means uncuttable. The atomists believed that the differences between one kind of material thing and another could be explained in terms of the qualities and organization of the atoms of which they are composed. Note how the rejection of the Thomist synthesis and its replacement with an atomist theory of matter required that the whole concept of the soul had to be rethought. In this new worldview, the soul could no longer be understood as the form of the body, there simply is no such thing as a form in Aristotle's technical meaning. There were two obvious responses. One was physicalism, first embraced by Thomas Hobbes in the 17th century. Hobbes's entire account of human nature was based on the notion of particles in motion. Sensation is due to pressure on the sense organs. Thinking is due to small motions in the head. Emotions are due to motions about the heart. Hobbes is best known now for his political philosophy. He explained the commonwealth in terms of attractive and repulsive forces among atomistic individuals. Hobbes's contemporary, René Descartes, chose the other obvious option. He returned to a radical dualism of mind or soul and body along the lines of Plato's and Augustine's. Descartes distinguished two basic kinds of created realities, extended substance and thinking substance. The latter included human minds. As I mentioned earlier, the words mind and soul were nearly synonymous. For Descartes, everything of which we are conscious is a function of the mind, and all of the other faculties, such as the ability to move, are attributed to the body. The Protestant reformers had already rejected Aristotelian thought, and most returned to an Augustinian dualism, though not one as radical as Descartes'. Section 5, the Darwinian Revolution. The Darwinian theory of evolution has had an impact on contemporary culture comparable to the revolution in physics and astronomy at the beginning of modern science. One of many issues it raised was continuity between humans and other animals. One way to respond to this continuity was to take it as an additional reason to question any form of dualism. Descartes described animals in purely material terms. Given his rejection of the scholastic idea of animal souls, the recognition of human kinship with and development from lower animals warranted the conclusion for many that humans too are purely physical. Many Christians evaded this materialist conclusion by granting that the human body could be a product of biological evolution, but maintaining that God creates a soul for each individual at conception. This position was adopted by many, including Pope Pius XII. It runs into difficulties, though, when we ask when the human species first appeared. Biologists offer a complex account of human origins in which there is no clear distinction between animals and humans. The branch of the evolutionary tree leading from our common ancestors with the apes to modern humans began 5 to 7 million years ago and includes a number of predecessor hominids. Were our first hominid ancestors human, or are only modern humans truly human, or did the change take place somewhere in between? To claim that humans alone have the gift of a soul seems to force an arbitrary distinction where there is much evidence for continuity. Accounts of recent Catholic thought usually take John Paul II to have reaffirmed Pius XII's dualism. But George Coyne, former director of the Vatican Observatory, argues that while John Paul quoted Pius, he himself never speaks of creation of a soul, but rather of the transition to the spiritual. This is language much easier to reconcile with evolutionary thought. Section 6, neuroscience and the mind-soul. I often give lectures like this one, calling into question the need for Christians to have any concept of the soul, But more than once, when question time comes, a student asks, "So what is your concept of the soul?" I reply, "I just spent 45 minutes telling you that I don't believe there is such a thing." So, of course, I don't have my own concept. However, if I did have a concept of the soul, I would prefer Thomas's, not because of his use of the metaphysical concept of form, but because I like to use his descriptions of the functions he attributed to the soul as a way of organizing the developments in biology, and especially neuroscience, that show we no longer need the concept of the soul. And here's where you'll want your handout, because I'm going to shoot at you a lot of Thomist vocabulary. As did Aristotle, Thomas attributed souls to plants and animals. The human soul could be called tripartite, incorporating the capacities of both plant and animal souls, as well as our own particular rational soul. The vegetative or plant soul, in the first instance, is simply the life principle. However, the question of what makes something alive is now handled by biology. Tentatively, I might say, but nonetheless, it's taken as a biological question. So we no longer need the ancient and medieval idea of the soul as a life force. Biologists today ask what the minimum requirements are for life. The basics are self-maintenance, growth, and reproduction. Thus, a sphere of proteins and other large molecules is living if, first, it has a membrane separating it from its environment. Second, the membrane is permeable enough to allow for intake of nutrients. Third, it has the ability to repair itself if damaged. And fourth, the ability to reproduce, even if only by splitting into two spheres, each of which grows large enough to split again. Note that the three functions Thomas attributed to the vegetative soul were growth, nutrition, and reproduction. The physicalist thesis is, as we go up the hierarchy of increasingly complex organisms, all of the other capacities once attributed to the soul will also turn out to be products of complex organization, rather than properties of a non-material entity. And we need to be careful to recognize the role of the environment and of complex social systems as well. The faculties Thomas attributed to the animal or sensitive soul were locomotion, appetite, sensation, and emotion. Thomas's distinction between plant and animal on the basis of the ability to move from place to place is still accepted. I once heard a lecturer describe a marine organism considered to be on the borderline between plant and animal. It spends most of its time attached to rocks, but during one phase, it develops a simple brain, detaches from the rock, and moves to an area with more nutrients. Then it reattaches and consumes its own brain. The lecturer likened it to a professor who had gotten tenure. The earliest and simplest form of locomotion is found in single-celled organisms equipped with flagella, fine whip-like structures that rotate and drive the cell forward. In humans and other higher animals, locomotion is controlled by a strip of cortex across the top of the brain, called, significantly, the motor cortex. These brain regions direct muscle movements by means of the efferent nervous system, and the brain continually receives feedback from the body regarding its position and movements. Thomas distinguished two sorts of appetites. The sort that we share with animals is directed towards sensible objects such as food or mates. Sense appetite includes a pleasure-seeking drive that inclines animals and humans to pursue what pleases their senses and avoid what hurts them. It also includes an aggressive drive that inclines them to resist threats. The aggressive drive is the source of the emotion, anger. The pursuit of food is a given for animals. In higher animals, it is mediated by the pleasure centers of the brain. Sexual desire is highly dependent on hormones. The hormone oxytocin is secreted by the pituitary gland in mammals during sexual intercourse and breastfeeding. It has been found to be a significant factor in pair bonding and facilitates mother-infant bonding in humans. A lot of research has been done on the role of the brain and extended nervous system in sense perception. For example, visual perception in higher animals has developed from single light-sensitive cells in primitive organisms. In human vision, signals are transmitted from two different kinds of light-sensitive cells in the retina through a series of processors to the visual cortex. The striking difference between lower and higher animals is that while the lower ones can respond to stimuli in their environments, they do it without knowing what they are doing. In other words, they lack consciousness. There's a phenomenon called blindsight that helps make clear the difference between conscious and non-conscious perception, which for Descartes, by the way, would have been a purely nonsensical comment. Certain victims of damage to the visual cortex are either completely blind or have blind spots in their visual fields. Nonetheless, they're receiving information about their environment. If they're asked to say where an object is, they say that they don't know. But if they're told to reach for it, they do a much better job than would be expected by chance. So the value of consciousness is that we not only know things about our environment, but we also know that we know. How consciousness arises from brain function is, as neuroscientists say, the really hard problem. Since experts still don't agree on this, I'll need to skip over it. Back to Thomas. In addition to the five exterior senses, he postulated four interior senses. These are really interesting in that they show Thomas's skill as a cognitive scientist and also link up with detailed work in neuroscience. These are attributes shared with higher animals. Here is Timothy McDermott's contemporary translation of Thomas's account. Quote, higher animals must be aware of something not only when it is present to their senses, but also in its absence so that they can be prompted to seek it. So they not only need to receive, but also to retain impressions of sense objects presently affecting them. This ability to retain sense impressions in the absence of the stimulus is the interior sense he called the fantasia in Latin and often translated as imagination. In addition, he says, animals need to be attracted and repelled not only by what pleases or displeases their senses, but by what is useful or harmful in other ways. Birds collect must look good for nest building. So animals must be able to perceive the significance in things that is not merely an externally perceptible quality. Animals must therefore have an instinctive judgment, the vis estimativa, also translated as estimative power, and a memory, vis memorativa, or sense memory, for storing those. For what is memorable to animals is what is harmful or agreeable. Particular senses discern the particular sense stimuli proper to them, but to distinguish white from sweet, we need some common root sensitivity in which all sense perceptions meet, the sensus communis, or common or unifying sense, end quote. In this last sentence, Thomas is talking about the issue neuroscientists call the binding problem. That is, how is it that we can put together the sound of a bark, the sight of brown fur, the sensation of the softness of the fur, and the smell to recognize that what we have before us is a dog? This is considered to be one of the hardest problems in neuroscience, next to that of consciousness itself. Thomas's vis estimativa is a particularly interesting faculty from the point of view of neuroscience. What Joseph Ledoux writes about emotional appraisal is relevant to distinguishing this estimative power from the sensus communis. Quote, when a certain region of the brain is damaged, namely the temporal lobe, animals or humans lose the capacity to appraise the emotional significance of certain stimuli, but without any loss in the capacity to perceive the stimulus as an object. The perceptual representation of an object and the evaluation of the significance of an object are separately processed in the brain. In fact, the emotional meaning of a stimulus can begin to be appraised before the perceptual systems have fully processed the stimulus. It is indeed possible for your brain to know that something is good or bad before it knows exactly what it is. End quote. So in Thomas's terms, the vis estimativa is a separate faculty from the sensus communis, and it works faster. I've come to notice this difference myself. When the phone rings, I sometimes jump before I actually hear it, and then jump again when the sound reaches conscious awareness. Thomas wrote that the vis estimativa is also able to recognize intentions. Leslie Brothers has contributed to an understanding of the neural basis for such recognition in both humans and animals. Humans and other social animals come equipped with neural systems that predispose them to pick out faces. The amygdala is necessary for interpreting facial expressions, direction of gaze, and tone of voice. Brothers has shown that neurons in the same region are responsive to the sight of hands and of leg motions typical of walking. Where do we go? We're back? Okay. Thus, there are particular neurons whose function is to respond to visual stimuli that indicate the intentions of other agents. Ledoux's research is also relevant to Thomas's vis memorativa, the ability to remember the emotional significance of a stimulus. He tells of the patient of a physician named Clopperade, who had lost all of her abilities to create new memories due to brain damage. Ledoux reports, each time Clopperade walked into the room, he had to reintroduce himself to her, as she had no recollection of having met him before. One day he tried something new. He entered the room, as on every other day he held out his hand to greet her. In typical fashion, she shook his hand, but when their hands met, she quickly pulled hers back, for Clopperade had concealed a tack in the palm of his hand and had pricked her with it. The next time he returned to greet her, she still had no recognition of him, but she refused to shake his hand, but she couldn't tell him why. Clopperade had come to signify danger. He was no longer just a man, but had become a stimulus with a specific emotional meaning. She learned that Clopperade's hand could cause her harm, and her brain used this stored information, this memory, to prevent the unpleasantness from occurring again. End quote. By studying fear conditioning in rats, Ledoux has confirmed the crucial role of the amygdala, a distinctive cluster of neurons in the anterior temporal lobe of each hemisphere, in developing this sort of memory. Back to Thomas. He argues that it is the rational soul that makes us distinctively human. He attributed to it two sorts of intellect, passive and active, and the will. The active intellect is the power humans have, but not animals, of acquiring abstract information from experience and forming judgments. Its capacities are expressed primarily in the use of language. Passive intellect is a kind of memory, a memory of facts and ideas. Neuroscientists now distinguish something like a dozen different memory systems. The two sorts of memory that Thomas distinguished are both classified as types of declarative memory and involve the medial temporal lobes of the brain. The formation of long-term memory requires the functioning of the hippocampus. The functions Thomas attributed to the active intellect, abstraction, judgment, and reasoning, are less well understood in neurological terms than the faculties we share with animals. However, all of these higher human capacities depend on language, and a great deal of work has been done on the neural bases of language use. This is a two-step process. First, the cognitive capacities that go into language, such as knowledge of the meanings and recall of the sounds of words, need to be identified. Second, this cognitive architecture needs to be mapped onto the brain. Two regions of the brain have long been known to be involved, Wernicke's area and Broca's area. This is just the beginning of an understanding of the very complex brain processes that enable us to engage in language-based reasoning. The third of Thomas's rational faculties was the will. This is the capacity to be attracted to goods of a non-sensory sort. As Anthony Kenny says, the will is, quote, a power to have wants that only the intellect can frame. We can say roughly that the human will is the power to have those wants which only a language user can have, end quote. Along with intellect, this is the seat of moral capacities. Furthermore, since God is the ultimate good, the will accounts for the capacity to be attracted to God. Neuroscience now contributes to our understanding of both morality and religious experience. Antonio Damasio has studied the neural processes that go into practical reasoning, that is, the ability to make both moral and prudential judgments. In his book, Descartes' Error, he reports the case of a 19th century railway worker, Phineas Gage, whose brain was pierced by a metal rod. Gage recovered physically, and his cognitive functions, attention, perception, memory, reasoning, language, were all still intact. Yet he suffered a dramatic change in character after the accident. The doctor who treated him noted that he had become fitful, irreverent, indulging in the grossest profanity, which was not previously his custom, manifesting little deference for his fellows, impatient of restraint or advice when it conflicts with his desires, end quote. Hanna Nabasio was able to determine from the damage to Gage's skull exactly which parts of the brain would have been destroyed, selected areas of his prefrontal cortices. The Damasios conclude from this and other similar cases that this area is, quote, concerned specifically with unique human properties, among them the ability to anticipate the future and plan accordingly within a complex social environment, the sense of responsibility toward the self and others, and the ability to orchestrate one's survival deliberately at the command of one's free will, end quote. In short, what Thomas described as the appetite for the good appears to depend on localizable brain functions. A number of scientists have begun to study the role of the brain in religious experience. For example, patients with temporal lobe epilepsy often develop strong interests in religion, and some speculate that the temporal lobes are involved in normal religious experience as well. Andrew Newberg has studied Buddhist monks during meditation and Franciscan nuns during prayer, and shows particular regions of the brain to be typically activated. I'm often asked to comment on these brain imaging studies. I always point out that if one is a physicalist, as I am, it is not surprising that brain regions are involved in religious experience. In fact, some regions would have to be. I also point out, though, that these studies say nothing about the existence or non-existence of God. In this section, then, I've gone down one of the most detailed lists available of the human capacities that have been attributed to the soul in the past, but I've just barely scratched the surface of the neuroscientific work that has been done on each of these capacities. Section 7, the really hard philosophical problem. I denied earlier that there is a war between modern science and Christianity. This may appear to be the case, given that most Christians are dualists and most neuroscientists and other biologists are physicalists. Since there is a growing recognition among scholars that dualism is a later importation of Greek philosophy into theology, I would say that the real issue between Christian teaching and the views of many philosophers and scientists is that of reductionism. Christians need to hold out for non-reductive physicalism, agreeing with Donald Mackay's rejection of what he called nothing buttery, that is, we're not just biological organisms. Recall what I said earlier about the biblical view being well described as multi-aspect monism, because the biblical authors recognize not just physicality and spirituality, but also emotionality, moral capacity, relationality, and so forth. Have we lost any of this when we investigate how all of it appears to arise from our immense biological complexity and thousands of years of cultural development? So the tough question is this: if humans are purely physical, then how can it fail to be the case that all of our thoughts and behavior are simply determined by the laws of neurobiology? I began in the 1990s working with my neuropsychology colleague, Warren Brown, on this issue. We were convinced that reductionism had to be false. Philosophers and scientists like Daniel Dennett and Francis Crick could be reductionists when it came to free will, morality, emotions, and so forth, but they never got around to applying it to their own thinking. If all of our thoughts, including the ones they write in their own books, are determined by neurobiology, then in what sense could they be true? In fact, do they even mean anything? If reductionism and determinism are true, then I had to come here today, and my brain is causing me to make these noises at you. But the whole idea of rational persuasion has gone out the window. You will go home thinking what you think, regardless of what I say. Warren and I decided that while there were a lot of valuable resources for devising a non-reductive physical account of human nature, no one had yet put them all together to make the necessary argument against neural determinism. We each had different ideas about where to start, but didn't know where we would end up. It took us nearly 10 years to work this out in our book, Did My Neurons Make Me Do It? Unfortunately, the book has not won over a large audience, so this is something that scholars, especially Christian ones, need to continue working on. The direction, I believe, involves a new development going on right now across all of the sciences, the development of what is called complex systems theory. According to this theory, as systems become more complex, they develop new causal capacities and become increasingly self-directed, affected in more limited ways by either their constituents or their environment. In the case of humans, we have become agents, having the capacity to choose many of our own actions. Conclusion. My overall claim, one that I can't come close to fully supporting in just one paper, is that support for a physicalist theory of human nature comes from five directions: biblical studies, history of the development of doctrine, systematic theology, cognitive neuroscience, and philosophy. So I'm going to end at this point because I've wanted to leave plenty of time for discussion and questions, and I'm looking forward to hearing from you all. Thank you.
So thank you, Nancy, for that very brilliant, really brilliant lecture. I'm sure you have a lot to think about. And what we usually do at this time is to spend a few minutes at the tables trying to, sift out what would be a good question, what do I understand, where do I want to go next. So those of you who are, alone, you might want to move in with someone else. And just spend a few minutes. And then after that, what we'll do is open the floor for questions. And when you formulate your question, make sure it's a short question, not another lecture, okay? So, all right, enjoy yourself. All right, so if we could maybe get together again, and if someone would like to begin with a question.
Thank you. Thank you for an excellent lecture. Very, very clear, very succinct, really evocative. Evocative for me in causing me to think about world religion, the fact that a number of world religions, Eastern religion, for example, espouse a belief in a cosmic consciousness, and that there's this consciousness, however you might want to name it, which is beyond us in some mysterious way, and that rather than the brain or physicality or body, biology, chemistry, all that stuff, creating that quote-unquote reality, our own physicality, our DNA, our brains, the sum total of who we are as human beings serve as receptors, allowing us to receive that consciousness, which is really not physical at all. It's just we are the receptors. Could you speak to that maybe?
Well, I know that in early Greek thought, a distinction was not yet made between the ability to understand something rationally versus the thing itself being inherently rational. And so once that distinction is made, then the question arises in a way that it couldn't before as to whether an essentially physical entity can have the capacity to understand a non-physical being or state of the universe or whatever. But I don't think I have much more to say to that, except that I have noticed among the Christians that I speak to that their understanding of the nature of their own souls is actually more akin to Gnostic belief than it is to standard Christian teaching. because they actually see their souls as divine-like, or even divine, perhaps. And then they ask the question, well, without that divine stuff in me, how could I possibly make have a connection with the divine God out and about? So, but that's, I really don't have a great answer to that question.
Testing.
There's a gentleman at this table who asked a question.
Talk a little louder because
There's a gentleman at my table who asked an interesting question, which I'm not going to try to preempt, but I'm going to ask a cognate question. When I was a professor during the 1970s at Millersville, I had repeatedly a very, very terribly sad experience of having to speak to undergraduate students whom I knew to be flirting with drugs. And I would explain to them that taking drugs will ultimately rob you of your soul, I said. Now, if I were a physicalist, I would walk away from that conversation thinking I had actually said something that at least intellectually requires translation into other language. And the immediate kind of language that comes to mind would be something like this. Taking drugs will gradually turn you into a sociopath. But from the physicalism as I understand it, and that's not satisfactory either, because underlying that kind of discussion, that kind of discourse, is a thinly veiled notion of causation running from biochemistry to the higher ethical faculties, such as awareness of moral responsibility. Right. And consequently, a form of dualism.
No. The issue that you're raising is whether physicalism requires that there be no bottom-up causation in the production of higher mental capacities. And physicalists do not claim that. They claim that in addition to the effects of the whole physical organism, including what it puts in its mouth and nose, there are effects on at the cognitive level from those substances, changes, etc. I'm well aware of what drugs do to the personal characteristics of young people who take them. I worked at the Nebraska Psychiatric Institute for a semester, and we had young people there who simply had behavioral problems. But there was a large group of them who either had naturally become schizophrenic or they had become like schizophrenics because of sniffing glue or sniffing gasoline. So I would substitute there for a sociopath, I'd substitute something more like psychotic or schizophrenic. But no, there's no denial that in all cases there is a contribution of biology. And even the restriction of food or water has dramatic effects on cognitive abilities after a specified length of time.
But those cognitive abilities, state them. Simply describing the cognitive abilities or their absence doesn't necessarily carry with it any moral or ethical purchase.
Well, it does if you lose the cognitive abilities that we have as mature humans that are required for the process of moral reasoning. And I take these to be the ability to understand the culturally and theologically developed concepts of morality. And Catholics regularly assume that children over the age of seven or older, have those abilities. It also requires the capacity for what we call self-transcendence, the ability to be self-conscious of what I'm doing and why I'm doing it, and then ask whether the doing of it is a good or a bad thing. I follow Alistair MacIntyre in his description there, and the best source is his Dependent Rational Animals.
So the theologian, the historical theologian, what is the value behind taking away the word soul?
Well, there, these sorts of historical judgments are never easy to confirm. But I believe that that having a dualistic conception of the person allows for a dualistic conception of salvation, which concentrates on saving the souls, even if it's at the expense of the body. And it doesn't always have to happen. I think of Teresa of Avila, definitely a body-soul dualist and one of the finest craftspersons of our account of God's, of meeting God within one's soul. But yet she was a tireless worker in reforming and establishing convents. So being a dualist doesn't necessarily make you forget about the physical needs and reality of human beings, but there, I think there's a tendency to do so. And I could probably think of other instances to go along with that.
A follow-up to that very quickly. So you think that the dualistic nature has a tendency toward violence?
No. No, when I was speaking at Villanova last night, I pointed out that some people believe that Christian dualism provides the backing for a number of Christian moral prescriptions, such as abolition of or limitation on abortion, rejection of infanticide, and so on. But you can also say that body-soul dualism with regard to humans has also given license for disregard and abuse of animals. You can also use it as a means for discriminating between men and women by saying that both men and women have souls, but men are more soulish and women are more physical. In their natures, and so on and so forth.
That was exactly what I was. So, one more question. You mentioned the idea of complex system theory,
mm-hmm.
And you also mentioned the idea that neuroscientists struggle with the understanding of consciousness and its structure. Wouldn't or couldn't that produce a kind of rational agnosticism of withholding judgment as to whether one was a materialist or a physicalist or a dualist, as in that I know that I don't know what the nature of consciousness is, couldn't I withhold judgment until more data is in?
Well, of course, you always can, because no argument based on empirical studies is ever entirely conclusive. What I would say is that so much is known about particular capacities, conscious or unconscious, and their relationship to brain processes, that the burden of proof has shifted to the dualist to explain why we need this additional entity, the mind or soul. And also, it reminds me of a comment I heard somebody making about the suggestion that consciousness must have something to do with quantum activity. Penrose?
Deepak Chopra.
Well, this was a comment made about Penrose, and it was boiled down to, we can't understand quantum processes, we can't understand consciousness, therefore quantum processes and consciousness have to be related. And I'm not accusing you of that by any means, but it just reminded me of that. I want to come back to Father Allen for just a minute. To talk just about the pragmatic value of physicalism over dualism for ethical purposes is really not true to my vocational goals. I want to argue for physicalism because I think it's true.
You want to respond to that?
Yeah.
All right. I'll let you have it one more time.
Meaning, I don't put on the word soul an entity that is separate from body or distinct from body, because I grow up in an Augustinian tradition which acknowledges the letter to the Philippians that Christ is in the form of God and in the form of servant. And so there's a sense of inner unity that the word soul provides that is not in distinction from or in opposition to the body. So for you to, for you to say, well, you use the word soul, therefore you're a dualist, no. But we could have a good fight on that one, and it would be lots of fun to do it. But I would want to use soul as my entry into the unity of the human person, rather than using body as the entry into the unity of the human person. But I think we would be trying to do the same thing through a different door.
Well, I think the direction you would go is more biblical, and mine is more contemporary. But I can't remember if I said this last night or down in Atlanta. Did I talk about putting some words to bed for a while? Because there are such ingrained notions of what they mean in the culture at large, that however cautiously, subtly, you define and delimit your use of the word soul, in the general culture, it's just going to sound like that ghost-like thing that goes to heaven when we die. That's just the way people are.
Yes, I know that dualism is not very popular these days with experimental psychologists and neuroscientists and all that sort of thing. And free will is a huge problem. You don't hear psychologists or neuroscientists waxing rhapsodic about free will, but yet one could argue that free will is the primary datum of human experience. And I would make such an argument.
Yeah. If you ask what are the aims of any science, it's to see how far you can go in explaining the phenomena you're interested in naturalistic causal terms. And so to be a psychologist requires you to adopt a stance of of unfreedom. That is, if you start out saying, all of our actions or many of our actions are simply choices of free will, then there's not much point in trying to study what causal conditions will produce regularly certain outcomes in human behavior. So you can be a neuropsychologist like my friend Warren Brown, and you don't invoke free will in your scientific work because that's just not part of what science is there to do. But that doesn't detract in the least bit from his Christian commitment, his ability to take all of those hours and hours away from his brain research in order to try to write a book on a philosophical book on how free will is nonetheless possible, despite all that we know about conditioning of human behavior by both environment and biology.
Those are interesting thoughts. I have in mind a statement that our good friend Jack Haught made, and that is when he remarked that we should not deny in our philosophy what we believe in our hearts, which is a kind of nice way of putting it.
I don't think... my first impulse is to say that philosophy is different from science. I don't believe, I'm sure philosophy does not require methodological naturalism or methodological atheism.
Yeah.
And why do we have the Society of Christian Philosophers, for instance? But there's another problem that believing in my heart brings up. And this comes from an earlier book that New Testament scholar Joel Green put together, an edited collection called Whatever Happened to the Soul. And we have a Christian philosopher in there, Stephen Getz, who says that when he looks inside himself, he finds that at his deepest reality, he is a soul. Nonetheless, Getz quotes Peter Van Inwagen in his own chapter, who says, when I think most deeply about what I am, I find that I am a thinking animal. So we often have deeply held intuitions about various issues that come up in philosophy. And we have to recognize the role that previous versions of philosophy or previous versions of theology have had in shaping us to have those assumptions, which we uncover when we look deeply into what we are in ourselves.
All right. The one question I really want you to ask you is that if we subscribe to a theory of embodiment of physicality, we know our bodies die, and we know what happens after death to our bodies. But does this not imply there is no such thing as life after death?
If you're in a Christian context, God, no. the good news of the gospel is, when it's being spoken to the Hebrews, is in contrast to what you may have thought in terms of the death of your particular body being the end of you, and the consequent emphasis on leaving behind progeny to carry on your line. The good news is you may die physically, but you do have a future eternal life. And you find that in later Judaism, but it comes particularly clear after the resurrection of Jesus. What surprised the disciples was not so much that he was resurrected, but that resurrection was expected among the Jews who did expect it to be at the end of history, not in the middle of history. But if you're Paul and you're preaching to the Corinthians and you've got a bunch of body-soul dualists there who think that their souls already are immortal and that the goal of life is to live in such a way that your soul will escape from bodily existence and return to its proper place in a transcendent realm, then you're asking, why on earth would I want to hear this as good news? So I think that explains why Paul is so difficult to interpret. When he's speaking to a mixed Jewish and Gentile audience, he's got to, in one letter, address the worries on both sides.
Yeah, I don't know whether it's a question, but I was reading this summer about the internal alchemy of the Taoist. And they think of the body in three different ways, and I'm not sure that I have it straight yet. But the physical body, you know, what we would think of, but the cosmic body, you know, that we're one with all of creation. Mm. And then a third one, which would be, I think, comparable to the resurrected body. Uh-huh. So this was like a new way. I really like the idea of the cosmic body as a, and I don't know if that fits into your system.
Well, I don't know exactly what's meant by a cosmic body, but I do believe it's been a mistake in modern Western thought to be so certain that I end where the edge of my skin ends.
Exactly. Uh-huh.
And I think a much more Hebraic understanding would be to say that I am actually present wherever I'm having an effect. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And families are extended wholes, and the nature of the family is partly what makes me what I am. And so the way I behave affects that surrounding environment.
Right. With the internet now, we can be affecting the whole world, right?
For good or ill.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, good. Thank you. Okay. One more.
I'm full of sympathy with this, but frankly, it's hard for me to understand how the belief in the resurrection of the body interdigitates comfortably with physicalism. Because if physicalism is true, then the laws of thermodynamics are true. And the resurrection of the body implies either a spontaneous decrease in the entropy of the universe, or else an injection of energy from the outside.
Actually, the Christian concept of resurrection is best understood not as just one more event in the course of history. If you try to think of, for instance, the whole human race being wiped out on the face of the earth, and then God intervening and raising up humans to go traipsing around on the surface of the physical earth forever, that's nuts, because we know that the earth is going to be fried in 4.5 billion years. And depending on where the cosmologists stand in a particular year, the cosmos is either going to continue to spread out and cool off, and how would we have a location in which to be gathered if that's the case? Or else it's going to collapse and burn. And so whereas it used to be intelligible to think that humans alone might be raised from the dead, we have, first of all, to recognize that the New Testament accounts of Jesus as resurrected are inherently inconsistent. And some people would say that that argues against the historicity of the resurrection. What I argue, and what other people I think would agree with, is it shows that one cannot describe in the language and concepts that apply to this world as it is what a resurrection body is like. And the best way to convey that it is that fact is with contrasting stories in order to say, no, it's not just a ghost. No, it's not just an apparition, but no, it's not simply a resuscitated body. And then as you think about the impracticality of trying to talk about resurrected, transformed humans in a non-transformed cosmos, it makes you pay more and more attention to tiny little clues, such as in Paul's letter to the Romans, that the whole creation is waiting in eager longing for its transformation. And so systematic theologians such as Wolfhart Pannenberg say that what the belief in the resurrection entails is that the entire cosmos looks forward to transformation as radical as the transformation that occurred in Jesus when he was raised from the dead.
Well, it looks as if we've had a...
One more? Okay, good.
Just a simple observation. Yes. Thanks so much, Nancy. What you just said, you're standing here next to Kathy Duffy, and what you just said reminded me, doesn't that sound Teilhardian?
Teilhard.
We were talking about this afternoon, and I haven't read Teilhard since the 1970s. But from what I do remember all the way back, I think it would be wise to take another good look at him.
Mm, yeah. So you get an A, Ed. Anyone in my class who is able to put Teilhard into their paper gets an A. Well, on that note, I think we can finish and thank Nancey one more time for you. Definitely she has us thinking. So thank you so much for coming and for being with us. And thank you all for coming out this dark but beautiful night, right? So, and don't forget to come back next month and in the future, okay? We have lots of good things in store. All right, thank you. Yeah, you come back too.
Nice job.
Thank you. Yeah, wasn't that good? Thank you. You were wrong.